Welcome everyone to today's session. So today we're going to be talking about deployment strategies for a hybrid cloud environment. And this is a joint session between Octopus Deploy and Aptum. So we have Ian and myself here, and we'll introduce ourselves shortly. But just a couple points of housekeeping. This is a live webinar, and it's very live. So if you have any questions as we go through, please feel free to add them in the comments, and we'll get to those at the end. But the other key point is this is being recorded, so there's no need to take notes as you go. We will send out a recording, so you'll get a full copy of it. So first, hello from Aptum and Octopus. We'll just do some quick introductions. Ian, did you want to introduce yourself?
Sure, yeah. Hello, everybody. So my name's Ian Crosby. I'm a field CTO at Aptum. Aptum is a global managed and service provider. Essentially, we solve for cloud. We do public cloud, private. We have our own hosting co-location, and any solution in between. So talking about hybrid cloud is something which is very common in my day-to-day and a subject close to my heart.
That's excellent. That's great, Ian. Thank you. So my name is Rob Pearson, and I'm a solutions engineer at Octopus Deploy. Octopus, if you haven't heard of it, is a DevOps or deployment automation tool. And I'm a developer. My background is technical, so I wrote code for about 20 years. But more recently, I've become a solutions engineer where I work with both customers and partners. And mentioning partners, Octopus and Aptum are partners to help companies around the world with their IT and DevOps or deployment automation needs. So what are we going to talk about today? We're going to kick off first and introduce our context and domain. And we'll talk about some of the specific challenges and pain points that teams encounter in a hybrid environment. Then we'll shift to strategies, approaches that you can take to be able to work successfully within this realm. Then we'll jump to a demo. We'll first have a walkthrough of how you can get started, a walking skeleton, and then I'll jump into a demo and show a little bit of how you can take next steps with Octopus Deploy. And finally, what we'll do at the end is we'll answer any questions that you might have that you've asked throughout the presentation. So kicking off, really, what is a hybrid cloud? And to me, like, I've been in IT for quite a while, so I remember kind of the evolution, thinking back from physical servers through to kind of the virtualization or VM evolution through to modern cloud native technologies, Kubernetes, serverless, etc. And to me, hybrid is a mix of environments, infrastructure environments throughout those and along the way, because it really enters into kind of brownfield and greenfield applications. I'm sure we've all worked on similar projects. Greenfield applications, if you've worked on one, it's a brand new project where you get to make all the decisions up front about what technologies, what infrastructure you're going to use. You make those decisions and you evolve it moving forward. And often that uses the latest and greatest technologies. But not all of us can do that. I think throughout my career, most of the projects that I worked on were brownfield. So what's a brownfield application? To me, it's an existing application that has a mix of kind of good and bad decisions, architectural points, and even infrastructure. So often brownfield applications have been around for years, and large business critical ones can be around for 5-10 years, etc. And so decisions have been made, and there's a lot of bad ones that you have to live with, and that adds constraints. But as you move forward and things go out of support, often you're forced to modernize. And most teams and companies can't stop everything and rewrite an application. You have to do parts, or the parts that you're forced to. And so that's often done through IT transformation projects or app modernization, whereby you're integrating with legacy services that still run on VMs, maybe on-prem in data centers, but you might have parts that have been moved to the cloud, even a lift and shift, or even brand new modern components, serverless containers, etc. But it's really that mix of old and new technology. That's the way I think about it. But what are some of the challenges? The main one from my own experience that I've faced, I think it most often it's cognitive load. It's that you're dealing with multiple technologies. Like if you think about older technologies where you're deploying to web servers on virtual machines, integrating with legacy components, etc., that has its own complexities, through to a modern full stack, which has like a modern full stack, JavaScript front end, all the modern technologies there, through to back end services. And so that entire mix, if you have a mix of old and new technologies, it can be very challenging to understand the whole solution. And often what happens is you have people who have worked on those systems for years, and so they understand all the complexities and considerations. They might have notes, they remember when things broke and where you have to tread carefully. And this very much often involves some mixed infrastructure, that range of new and old. But one of the greatest pain points when working on one of these systems, a brownfield application, is that it can be hard to change and scary to deploy. And the challenge with that is often when something's scary to deploy, you do it less often. And so where modern teams might ship once a week or a couple times a month, et cetera, or even multiple times a day, when it's hard, you might deploy once a quarter. And the challenge with that is releases grow in size. And with a larger, more complicated release, you get more risk. And so what can happen is when you do deploy, because it's such a big, complicated release, you can have failures, outages, incidents, and it's a negative cycle. And so that's one of the biggest problems that I've seen, both from my own experience as well as customers who work in this space.
Cool. Thanks, Rob. So I'll jump in here and talk a little bit more about that, right? And you know, we talk about legacy systems and the challenges that brings, but it's also important to remember that, you know, having a legacy system means that you've had a business which works, right? So it means you had a successful run. So it's not all negative, the fact that you do have to deal with this legacy system. But as Rob mentioned, it brings a lot of challenges, and specifically around the different technologies and trying to handle all the different infra, et cetera, that's there. Specifically thinking about hybrid cloud, I think one thing that's interesting is, you know, a lot of us are in this kind of domain where we're maybe in this in-between or mix between different clouds, on-premise and maybe public cloud is probably the most common. And there's maybe a few people in the case where this is an intermediary step, right? And for moving from an on-premise traditional infrastructure, moving everything to public cloud, and then great, then we can be fully kind of cloud native. But I would say most of us have kind of come to the realization that in most cases, this is a permanent state, actually, this state of hybrid cloud. And whether it's because we realize that full shift to the cloud is never going to happen, or maybe we realize that that's actually not what we need, right? What we're seeing more and more in the industry now is this, not necessarily a shift back to on-premise, but more a reevaluation of what is the right solution. So I really like the term of being cloud smart, to kind of replace that cloud first approach and looking at, for each of our components, each of our services, each of our applications, where does it make sense to run? And it's not always the case that public cloud is best, right? Maybe we have data residency requirements that we need to satisfy. Maybe we need to be closer to some of our end users and need something more edge-based. Maybe we have strong security constraints that need to be sorted out on-premise. Again, we're seeing more and more that hybrid cloud is kind of the de facto architecture that we're going to have going forward. But of course, that does bring a lot of challenges. And deploying our applications, deploying our services is key to evolving that into modernizing, right? Because we can't just do a full rewrite of everything. It's really not feasible in most cases. And I think gone are the days of the big 3-year plan to do a full rewrite of our entire architecture. Because the reality is we don't know even in 1 year what we're going to need or what's going to change in the landscape. So we want to shift to this more iterative approach and ideally build what's called an evolutionary architecture, right? So an architecture that is built for change so that when we do have to maybe move to a different location, we maybe have to move to a different cloud or maybe to the edge, our architecture is set up in such a way that it's much easier to do so, right? We're not closing doors as we go through. And again, having a nice deployment process is really critical to that. It allows you to ensure that those processes are smooth. And again, it's about not repeating past mistakes. So as we go through this iterative process, ensuring that we're learning properly. So I'm going to start kind of from the 10,000 foot view, right, of some strategies to actually try and approach and solve this. If you want to jump to the next slide, perfect. Sure. And we'll kind of break it down there and get to a little bit more practical, and eventually Rob will get to bring us down to earth with some actual tangible demos. But we think about, okay, we have this hybrid architecture. We want to modernize at least the way that we deploy. Maybe we want to modernize our architecture. It's really important to start from the beginning, right? Start at the business goals. What is it that we really are trying to achieve here? Because it can be different in each case, right? And sure, there are advantages of moving towards more frequent deployments and having a smoother process. But it's important to have in mind of what are the goals that we're trying to achieve. And ideally, what are the KPIs to measure that so that as we go through, we can evaluate where we stand. And I think it's, in kind of choosing a default, right, aiming towards continuous delivery is a nice kind of ambitious goal to set up, even in a complex hybrid brownfield environment, even if you realize that getting there could be a few years down the line or might never happen. If you have that as your goal, it really enforces a lot of the best practices, like automating things, like forcing you to do those more frequent deployments. Even though it's hard, if you do it more frequently, you necessarily iron out those wrinkles. So again, starting with what is the goal? Where is it we're trying to go? And then starting this iterative approach. So where do we start, right? And again, that can be pretty scary to understand. We look at this giant architecture, all these technologies we have in place. How do I get started on this? And really, it's about picking one piece and iterating. And it can be, you can look at different reasons for choosing one piece over another. Maybe we look at what's a piece which we deploy often or change often. That might be something that we can start with because the gains will be a lot bigger. Or anything that we're currently doing manually. Well, if we start automating that, again, that's going to be a really big gain. So picking a certain piece we're going to start with and then taking iterative approach to that. The next piece here is about, so talk about rehost and replatform, but in any of these kind of modernization projects, right, you've got the wide range of R's, right? You evaluate each aspect and it's, do we retain, do we retire, do we rehost, replatform, refactor? But when we're specifically thinking about deployment, I think rehost and replatform are really powerful because of this homogeneous environment that we have, we really want to get the right abstraction layer where we can have kind of commonality. And the higher up you can make at that abstraction, the easier things are going to become, which is where, for example, containers bring a lot of value, right? Because in theory, you can run almost anything, just put it in a container. And, you know, if you're not refactoring your application, sure, you might not get some of the other benefits of containers like scalability or resiliency, but at least you have that common platform. And then you can treat these things the same way when it comes to deployment, when it comes to monitoring, when it comes to running them. So that's a really strong tool to kind of leverage. But of course, not everything, you know, can fit in a container, or not everything runs properly in a container. So we can look at things like rehosting. So essentially maybe lift and shift if we want to try and remove some on-premise service that we have. But again, these are, when we go through each piece, it's good to evaluate what can we do with this, right? Can we actually adjust this? Do we just want to automate things, or can we actually remove up that abstraction layer, for example, running it in a container? An example I can think of recently that I was working on a project, and it was a mix of Linux and Windows environments. And we kind of looked at evaluating, does it make sense to leverage Windows containers? And if anybody has used those in the past, you may be well aware that they're not the most efficient, right? Like a container can be many, many gigabytes, which means you don't leverage all of the traditional benefits you expect in containers, right? They're big, they're slow. But what it did still give us is, again, that common infrastructure that we could, at least all of the system, all of the components would still be in containers, so we could treat them in a similar way. But it's going to vary case by case. So a couple other strategies here, if we jump to the next slide, is, and this one might seem really simple, but automation is really, really essential. And it's something which I still see in many cases isn't pushed far enough. I've been doing this a long, long time, and I can't really think of an example where I ran into something which wasn't automatable. It may be cases that the effort required to actually automate a process or an activity isn't worth the payout, and that's fine as long as you can make that trade-off. But again, as we push towards having continuous delivery, automation is really essential. Obviously, it saves us time in automating things that were done manually. It removes the possibility of human error as much as possible, gives us repeatability. It allows us to layer things on top, like when we talk about maybe putting in security constraints, when we talk about compliance and auditing. If we have everything automated, it's much easier to then add on other things into that automation. Testing is another one, especially when we're talking about continuous deployment, right? We want to be confident that these scary deployments, you know, aren't going to break things when they run. So investing into having testing automation is hugely beneficial to gaining that confidence that when we're ready to push this thing out, it's not going to break. And this expands beyond just the applications, but, you know, pipelines as code. So your CI pipelines, having those as code, having those stored in Git, leveraging all of the same benefits that we see in software development to our pipelines, the same way that we do with infrastructure, brings a lot of benefits.
Yeah, I'll just jump in there too. And just to echo, like, the one thing we're hearing from a lot of teams that we work with at Octopus is developer productivity and developer experience are both becoming very, very important, almost critical, because especially the economy is shifting. And so making more from your team, or getting more productivity from your team, but also having the developers have a good experience, are very important. And that's how they see a lot of improvements and benefits to their teams and their companies moving forward. So we see that and we hear that quite a bit.
Yeah, absolutely. I, former developer, I hated when I had to do things manually and couldn't have automation. So absolutely. And then the last piece I want to touch on here is, measure what matters, right? And it's super important when you're going through this process that you have KPIs, something that you're measuring against to just gauge, are we actually improving, right? Are we getting to a better spot? Right. Sure, we're moving, but are we moving in the right direction? And ideally, you'll want to create some custom KPIs that align with your goals. But a really good place to start is with the DORA metrics, right? So how frequently are we doing deployments? What's the change failure rate on these deployments? What is the lead time to change? I'm missing one of them. Time to restore. So when error is time to restore. Again, this is just a good starting point. Customize them to what you need. But this is a good way to, again, evaluate over time of are we improving? And also to kind of show back to the business of here's the value that we've gotten from this investment. Along the same lines, fitness functions is something in the evolutionary architecture kind of domain. Again, just to evaluate as we're changing, are we getting better?
Yeah, that's excellent. Sorry, I switched ahead too quickly.
Okay.
So now we'll jump into the demos, and we'll Ian will kick off just with a modernization walkthrough. Apologies. So please continue.
Perfect. Thanks, Rob. I'm going to step down a little, maybe to like the 3,000 foot level, and just kind of walk through in practice what does this potentially look like. Some examples based on some projects that I've been involved in of how can you take these and actually start down this journey, right? Leverage things like starting to bring automation, getting towards this goal of continuous delivery. And again, we're all starting from a different place, so it depends on where you are. But I think this, try to make things a little bit more concrete. So starting point here, jump in, we show, you know, an architecture diagram, and you know, the specific components are don't matter that much in this case. But the idea is that, you know, we're starting from this brownfield state, hybrid state. We've got things on premise. We've got things in this case on Azure, and you know, we know that we needed to improve. We need to be able to improve our time to market. So again, as I mentioned, it's first about understanding where your goal is, and then okay, pick a starting point. So in this specific case, we decided to start with an authentication service, which existed. And this was pretty central to kind of all of the business logic. So it felt like a place where we could get a lot of value and prove out that things were going to, that this would show improvement. So we jump to the next slide. There was a high change rate as well. So this was getting deployed fairly frequently, and it was a partially automated, to be honest, a really manual process previously. So you see on the right essentially is this from GitHub Actions. This is a YAML code that defined that, a tool I personally like using, but again, it doesn't matter what your CI tool is there. It's about taking the steps which may have been manual and automating them, and then being able to build in things on top. So in this example, a Node.js app, doing some builds, running unit tests, and doing some linting or code analysis on top of that. Again, once you've got the base, it's really easy to introduce other pieces which can scale out, right? You can, especially if you're leveraging this pipeline as code, you have a baseline, and then every other service that you're gonna build on top of this or add in the CI and the CD can leverage from what you do for the first. So in this case, the second step, we actually moved to the replatforming and identified, well, actually, we could run this thing in a container. It would make things easier. There was already an AKS, an Azure Kubernetes service, which was running anyway, which we could run this on. So package it up in a container. Leverage the registry, and then we can add on other things like image scanning to identify CVEs. Again, with that common platform now, there's a lot more tools, a lot more benefits that we can gain. So that was great. We're starting to go down, start to improve. The next piece that we looked at was a pretty hairy legacy application. None of the people who had actually done any development work on it were still even around at the company. So there was a lot of fear of actually touching it, and a lot of skepticism that this thing could run in a container. So we opted with more just a rehost, right? Basically a lift and shift of it was running on a VM in a data center, shifted it to, in this case, an Azure VM. Again, we can leverage the same tooling. We get this abstraction of using the GitHub Actions to be able to deploy this, do our CI, run our tests, which are there, try and automate some of the pieces that were manually validated, and moving that into a cloud VM. And again, it's really just this iterative process, right? So in each step, you know, wash, rinse, repeat, and iteratively, we need to learn on this as well. So super value, I think, to have a dashboard of those metrics. So in this, just an example dashboard with specifically the DORA metrics there, just to kind of keep track of how you're doing. Again, you'll want to customize that to what is important for you. But having that constant feedback of, are we getting better? And, you know, if you take a step back, okay, well, let's learn. What did we do wrong? Or why aren't we getting the benefits we expected? Because it's that continuous approach, continuous learning, continuous feedback loops, which is really, really important.
That's great. So I think what Ian really talked about is it's really that foundation and how you can approach one of these existing, like a brownfield system, and start iterating and improving it. And all of those principles, I think, are fantastic. Now what I'm going to do, I'm just going to show you how things can be done with Octopus Deploy. And a lot of the things that I'm going to talk about are applicable if you're using a different tool chain or delivery pipeline. So there's lessons here, but I work for Octopus. I think Octopus is the best solution, but you can take something away from this depending, no matter what technologies you're working with. So Ian was talking about like a very interesting and complex system, but I wanted to use the example of how to modernize a line of business application and iterate on that deployment process continuously, evolutionary. So the example that I'll use is an order entry system. And I've seen this numerous times throughout my career at large companies in different industries. But effectively, we want to leverage some automation and we want to be able to iterate on the system, maintaining the current version, in our case, this is version 2, while building version 3. And so the example that I was going to present here is that we have a legacy order entry system and deploys to Windows virtual machines and even desktops, a desktop application. But in 2023, we need to modernize and they needed a modern front end. So how can we add a modern front end containerized deploy to Kubernetes so that, again, it's time to market, we can iterate quickly. But through that process, we want to maintain the existing production path to production while we iterate and start building out that next one. And once we've got the foundation, we can continue that rinse and repeat and iterate. And all the while, we want to support hybrid infrastructure. So now I just have to shuffle my screens and I'm just going to share my screen and I'll just jump in. Window. There we go. So very quickly, if you're not familiar with Octopus Deploy, I just wanted to show you where Octopus fits in a software delivery workflow. So this is a standard picture I like to show whereby you can have multiple teams writing code. They check their code into GitHub, and then they have a build server. And it doesn't matter which one you use, but to build your software, get started, run automated tests, do any scans, DevSecOps processes, etc. And very clearly, Octopus focuses on DevOps automation, but we do not do builds. But we integrate with all popular build servers. So in the case that I'm going to take a look at today, we'll integrate with GitHub Actions. But after the CI server has done its job, Octopus takes over and it takes those build artifacts, could be jars, NuGet packages, zip files, containers, and deploy them to a range of infrastructure. So in Octopus, you create projects, you automate the deployment process, and then you work through an environment-based workflow. And on the right-hand side, you can see here that, whoops, we have broad infrastructure support. So traditional web servers like IIS and Tomcat, but also the major clouds, Azure, Google, AWS, and Kubernetes. So a mix of that older technology as well as the newer technologies. So just jump quickly. This is my GitHub repo. And so this is a very simple demo application. But what we can see here, so this is my source code. So I've got a collection of code, a very simple application here. But the thing that I wanted to highlight is that I have a GitHub action CI process. And building upon what Ian was saying, I've got an initial process for both my production path, as well as updates on a branch for my new workflow. And so this builds my software, runs my tests, and publishes the artifacts. So the final step in my build process is to create a release in Octopus, and that's where we can complete that integration and that CI/CD pipeline. So this is my main dashboard in Octopus. I'm running in Octopus Cloud, and I'm running as an admin, so I have full access to do everything. But our main dashboard shows our deployment focus. I have a collection of projects down the left-hand side and a range of environments along the top. Dev, test, and production was very common. All of that can be customized to suit a team's environments or projects. They can be grouped and organized however they want. But the thing that I want to show here is that the release that I have in production right now, it was deployed today, could be a bug fix release, but that path to production still works. And so it's 2.1.0.88. But then I've had a couple new builds and releases that have gone into my dev and test environments. And so we'll jump into this project and see how everything is wired up. So this project, it maps to my source code repo and the application code and the artifacts from that. But what we're looking at here is my project dashboard. And so we see a range of releases and a bit more detail about what environments they've been deployed to. So again, we can see that last production deployment, that's version 2, the existing application, has been deployed to production. But my team has been iterating, and we're working on version 3. And in this case, we are deploying to separate infrastructure in our same environments, but they're different servers. And so what we can see here is I have deployed to dev and test, but I don't have any infrastructure connected to production. So I couldn't accidentally deploy to production. To see how everything works, I'm just going to kick off and show how we can deploy this latest release to our test environment. This is a deployment summary screen whereby I can customize when it's going to be deployed and customize some of the steps that are run. But in this case, I'm just going to click deploy and kick off the process. So as this progresses, I will see a nice summary of the deployment as we progress, and I get full logs of everything that's happening. But when I jump back to my deployment overview, I'll let that run because it will take a little while. I wanted to mention that releases in Octopus, it's a very key concept to our environment-based workflow. Releases snapshot all the dependencies required to be able to deploy successfully through environments. In this case, for this release, it snapshots all the package and container versions, as well as my deployment process and any configuration settings, which we call variables, so that I can successfully deploy to each environment running a single process. Now, I want to mention that this is a version controlled project. So I'm going to jump to my deployment process. And this is a series of steps that is my automated process to deploy my existing application. And you can see it has a simple approval and a notification, and I'm updating a database, and I'm deploying a couple of things to Windows Server and also Windows desktops. But what I need to do is I need to be able to iterate and update this so that my team can build the next version. So what I've done is I've created a branch in my repo, and my team can start working on the source code, but we can also evolve the deployment process. And so this is the next version of the deployment process. This is what we're executing right now. And so you can see what I've done. I still have my approval and my notification, but I've renamed a couple of the steps to indicate they're the older parts of it, legacy order service and the legacy desktop application. And I've started working to modernize the front end and be able to deploy my front end container to Kubernetes. Now, I'll just quickly show how one of these steps is configured. These are all using built-in steps within Octopus. And so all you have to do is provide some of your configuration settings to configure each step of the process. This is built up by using a range of built-in steps. Octopus has support, again, for new and old technology. So you can deploy to virtual machines, to web servers, or Java application servers, through to Kubernetes. And we also have over 500 steps contributed by our community. And the value of that is just helping with that automation to provide scripts so you don't have to write them. But with all that said, we'll jump back, and I think we can see that our deployment was successful. So on the same day, we've been able to deploy to both version 2 of our application to production, but we're still able to develop and iterate on our new version. And if I just jump back to my deployment process quickly, if I click create pull request here, it'll jump me over to GitHub. And what we can see is all the changes to my build process and my deployment process that go along with the code changes. And so I can evolve this all together, have reviews, and when we're ready, we can move forward. But that whole time, we're able to deploy to that mixed infrastructure hybrid, virtual machines, and more modern technologies like Kubernetes or other technologies like that. And so with that, I'm just going to stop sharing. And I'll jump back to our presentation. And now we're just open for questions. So if anybody has had any questions throughout today's webinar, feel free to ask. We do have one, so I'll just show that on screen now from Charles. We use Octopus to move our legacy systems between a development and production server. One of our server applications uses MySQL, a fairly large file system, a fairly involved background data pre-processing job service, a license server, web app, and a REST API. Second part. So that is a database, file system, and three different custom apps. Two things. Can you give me an idea of how we could move this everything on one VM system to a Kubernetes cluster? Also, how would we go about updating one aspect, for example, a MySQL update, safely with minimal downtime and rollback? Was that specific to Octopus? Or did you want to jump in any thoughts, Ian, first? And then I can jump in even from an Octopus perspective.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think kind of leading into that first question, one of the, my counter question are always kind of coming back is, I think it's important to understand of, first of all, what is it? Why is it you want to move this to a Kubernetes cluster, for example? At least to understand what is it, what are the benefits that you're looking to gain from there? Because that, that might dictate exactly how you would move it. Again, I would go for, like I mentioned, that kind of piece by piece deployment, so or piece by piece modernization. So I understand that they're all, depending on what they're currently running on, you know, first step would be validating that they can be containerized, right? The different portions. MySQL, something that I would tend to be a little more hesitant of still running a database in a container, especially something like MySQL. Depends on the use case. Sometimes it can fit. So then, you know, we look at more complete, right? If you're, for example, in a public cloud environment, is a managed database an option to go there? Personally, I have developed a deep-seated fear of databases. So whenever I can get somebody else to manage that for me, I consider that a win. So I'm a big fan of managed databases, but it, you know, it's going to depend on your use case, depend on your costs. But that's kind of the road that I would look at of like, what are we trying to achieve? Can we run these things in containers? Does that work? Can we leverage cloud services? And then just try it out in a proof of concept, first of all, to like validate that all these things work. And then from there, a gradual rollout. So maybe you have different versions and you can use advanced like routing to kind of to validate, you know, maybe you're running a version on-prem and a version in Kubernetes. Do some maybe canary, for example, where you're writing a certain amount of traffic, if that's supported, to kind of gain that confidence. Does it run before decommissioning the old version? There are different kind of strategies. Again, it super depends on your specific context, where you're coming from, what your needs are. But I think those are some general strategies that I've used around that.
Yeah, and I would echo that, especially so. If it all runs on one VM right now, like the biggest question would be if there's value in shifting to a cloud. Because if it's all in one VM, again, that lift and shift style is kind of common in the industry. But the next thing that I would think of, again, like very much a Kubernetes cluster, unless there's a strong benefit or need to run it in a Kubernetes cluster, I would stick with one of those managed database servers, Azure SQL or Amazon, like AWS, RDS, etc. Just for simplicity, scalability, and that it's that one of those dedicated solutions. But the approach to doing it, to be able to do it without downtime and be able to roll back. Again, the similar thing, it's the small changes so that it's incremental changes as best you can. Sometimes that's really difficult. A lot of times it can take a lot of thought to be able to think about what is high value? What do you need to change a lot? So that what is that priority of that first change, etc., and then be able to move forward and then pick off one service, be able to move it, containerize it, move it to a Kubernetes cluster, and then maintain both as throughout that process. So we have another question from Jake. Does the create pull request functionality work Azure DevOps or GitHub only? I believe that works with any Git provider, so it should work with both. So if you're using Octopus, most recently I've just used it with GitHub because that's what I typically use, but I believe it would work fine with Azure DevOps as well. We have a follow-up from Charles just on his, because he was explaining that the reason to shift to Kubernetes is to allow hot swaps of various services. And so I think the key part for that very much is Again, identifying those key services where it would add the most value to be able to deploy and be able to update them. And Kubernetes has a lot of support for scaling and deployment strategies. Octopus has some built in where you can do blue-green swaps. And I think there's a range of other patterns with Kubernetes clusters as well to be able to deploy without or deploy updates without downtime.
Yeah, exactly. Whether it's there's always the your application needs to be able to support it as well generally, but yeah, whether it's rolling deployments or blue greens, there's a lot of ways to really solve that. I think it's another interesting point Charles mentions there about being in needing to be in different regions, which I mentioned previously, can sometimes be a driving factor for some kind of hybrid. You know, if the cloud provider you're on has regions and all the places you need to be, great. Oftentimes they may not. And that's when you may need to leverage, you know, another localized third-party cloud or something else. And in these situations, I think this is what I find super interesting about Octopus, and I'm not going to try and fanboy on it, but like that visualization, that observability on when you have these multiple deployment targets, it's a challenge which I've run into with clients really often of like, we don't even know what version of our software is running in which deployment, right? So having just one kind of pane of glass to have that visibility and understanding and then to easily maintain it, I think is super powerful, especially when you get to this this kind of situation where you need to deploy in all these different areas and environments.
Absolutely. I think that is a nice benefit. The other thing that we didn't touch on just based on time is that Octopus supports tenanted deployments. And it's for complex scenarios, kind of like this, where it's multi-region. Depending on how you need to roll things out, whether it's deploying to different regions all at once or separately, by modeling different regions as tenants or even different sites, you can control the rollouts in a more intentional way. But basically, yeah, it can allow you to deploy to multiple regions, even multiple clusters per region, just based on your needs. Any other questions? If not, we might wrap up. So I'll go first. So thank you everybody for joining. I think it's been an excellent session. And if you'd like to learn more or see more about how Octopus can deploy to hybrid, even multi-cloud and tenanted deployment, something that I just mentioned briefly, you can go to octopus.com to learn more. We have you can start a free trial of Octopus, Octopus Cloud, or on-prem. Or if you'd like to see it in action, you can book a demo. Ian, did you want to mention something from Aptum?
Yeah, absolutely. So like I mentioned quickly on the start, we work with lots of companies who are in various forms of cloud adoption, whether it's on-prem or it's public cloud or a mix in between. Specifically that my main role is working with clients to identify what is the right strategy, what fits for your use case. So if you have any questions on what we covered or even broader of around cloud and your adoption strategy, if you could reach out to me directly. So my email is here. Happy to book a session to dive into something specific that you're trying to solve for.
So with that, thank you, everybody. I hope you've learned something. And
And an extra thanks to you, Rob, because I know it's almost 3 a.m., I think, where you are. So impressive.
It is fairly late, but it's been a great session. Thank you, everybody.